The committee will come to order, and the chair notes the presence of a quorum, which is only two members, so we're long over that. The Committee on Natural Resources is meeting today to hear testimony on an oversight hearing on state lands versus federal land, oil and gas production, what state regulators are doing right. Under Committee Rule 4F, opening statements are limited to the chairman and ranking member of the committee. However, I ask unanimous consent that any member that wishes to have an opening statement have it to the clerk prior to close of business today, and without objection, so ordered. I'll now recognize myself for my opening statement. Today we'll hear the story of two very different methods for energy production here in the United States. The energy production that occurs on state and private lands, and energy production that occurs on federal lands. Energy production on state and private lands is flourishing, creating jobs and thriving, healthy economies. These lands are the epicenter of energy renaissance that we are currently experiencing. On these lands, oil and natural gas production has increased dramatically since 2007. The restrictions on these lands are not as onerous, and as a result, the average time to get a drilling permit is only 12 to 15 days. Now contrast that with federal lands. There, the average time to get a drilling permit approved is 307 days, and that is nearly double what it took in 2005 when it was 154 days. Regulatory hurdles, long delays, and policies that keep federal lands under lock and key have become all too common, and as a result, federal oil and natural gas production has declined. We frequently hear from President Obama that U.S. energy production is an all-time high. It is, but he's only telling half the story. The story he's not telling is what multiple Congress Research Service reports have confirmed, and what this committee has been saying for the last 4 years, that all of the increase in U.S. energy production has occurred on non-federal lands, areas that are largely out of his administration's regulatory reach. This increase is happening in spite of the Obama administration policies, not because of them. We have a tremendous potential for new onshore oil and natural gas production on federal lands, but this administration is actively and purposely keeping these resources off limits. Perhaps one of the most egregious examples of this occurred earlier this year when the administration finalized plans to close over half of the National Petroleum Reserve Alaska, or NPRA, to energy production. So this administration is not only prohibiting energy production in new areas, but actually closing off millions of acres in an area that was specifically set aside for energy production. With potentially of nearly 3 billion barrels of oil and nearly 115 trillion cubic feet of natural gas in NPRA, it's no surprise that this decision received bipartisan opposition and criticism in Alaska and across the country. The administration is also planning to release new proposed rule on hydraulic fracturing on federal lands. It would be yet another layer of red tape and bureaucracy, since states have been successfully regulating fracturing for decades. Now, ironically, the administration apparently recognized this, because the most recent reconsideration of this rule asked for a focus on, and I quote, how to prevent duplication with the states, end quote. There's a simple solution to prevent duplication. Don't duplicate the states. The one-size-fits-all regulatory structure being pursued by this administration is a waste of time and energy. The difference in regulatory needs between Texas, Ohio, and Utah are about as diverse as they can be, yet the administration is proposing a one-size-fits-all rule on all federal lands, regardless of which state that's in. Over the past 2 years, the Natural Resources Committee has held at least 5 hearings between full committee and various subcommittees that focus on this issue. I intend for the committee to continue this oversight by announcing another hearing in early May on the administration's continued focus on duplicate, unnecessary, and costly regulations. The Obama administration's federal energy policies are costing American jobs, it's impeding economic growth and recovery, and robbing the U.S. Treasury of much-needed revenue to help balance our budget. We've seen how energy production on state lands can create jobs. We've also seen how energy production on state lands can help ease the pain of high gasoline prices. So why is this administration refusing to take the same steps as states to develop these resources? Well, today we'll hear testimony from local elected officials from Texas, Ohio, Utah, places that have seen firsthand the dichotomy between energy production on state and federal lands. I hope we learn more about what these states are doing to encourage new responsible energy production and how they can be a model for failed federal government policies. And with that, I yield back my time and recognize the distinguished ranking member.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. You know, last year, our oil production reached its highest level in 20 years, and it is still growing. In February, we produced more oil than in any month since November 1988. And because of all the above energy plan put in place by President Obama, we are now importing a smaller share of our oil from foreign countries than at any point in the last 25 years. When you combine this under President Obama, our dependence on foreign oil has fallen from 57% at the end of the Bush administration to 36% in 2013. And despite the claims of the majority, production from federal lands onshore is also increasing. Last year, oil production from federal lands onshore was 8% higher than in 2011. It was 16% higher than at the end of the Bush administration. And production from Indian lands has increased threefold from the last year of the Bush administration. During the first 4 years of the Obama administration, the Department of Interior has approved more permits to drill on federal lands onshore than during President Bush's first term. Industry has begun drilling more new wells during this time than in the first 4 years of the Bush administration. Meanwhile, the average time it takes the Interior Department to process a drilling permit once a company has submitted a completed application has decreased by 19% under this administration compared to the last 4 years of the Bush administration. The Interior Department implemented oil and gas leasing reforms designed to increase certainty and predictability, and the number of protested oil and gas lease parcels have decreased from 47% to 18% during the last 4 years. And the increase production on federal lands is all in spite of the fact that the oil and gas industry continues to hold the drilling rights to more than 25 million acres of federal lands onshore that are not producing oil or gas. This is an area the size of Kentucky that companies are just warehousing. The oil industry has nearly 7,000 drilling permits for federal lands onshore that have already been approved, that haven't been used yet, and have not been used yet. Drilling could happen under these permits immediately. But while the majority is busy claiming that the administration is somehow holding up production, they refuse to talk about the fact that oil companies are increasingly looking to export American resources abroad as oil and natural gas production rises. In fact, in 2011, we exported more refined fuels overseas than we imported for the first time since 1949. And now the oil industry has even begun calling for repealing the laws that prohibit exporting crude oil produced in the United States. Last month, the CEO of ConocoPhillips said that at some point we should even allow exports of oil to places like Latin America and Europe. The head of the American Petroleum Institute has made similar claims. The Republican slogan, drill here, drill now, pay less, has been the slogan, but we are increasingly seeing oil industries call to drill here, sell there, and pay more. This is not acceptable. The benefits of our increased oil and gas production should go to American consumers and American businesses. Ranking Member Markey and Representative Holt have introduced legislation to ensure that oil and natural gas produced from our public lands, which belongs to the American people, stays in America to benefit all. We should ensure that we use this domestic resources to benefit American consumers, our economy, and our national security. This is what we should be talking about today, but we're not. And we should be talking about the public resource that we have, paid for and owned by the taxpayer, and the owners and taxpayers deriving a direct benefit from that public resource. And so with that, Mr. Chairman, thank you, and I yield back.
I thank the gentleman for his opening statement, and I want to welcome our panel that we have here. We have the Honorable Greg Bell, the Lieutenant Governor of the great state of Utah, Mr. Richard Simmers, Chief of the Division of Oil and Gas Resources Management with the Department of Ohio Department of Natural Resources, I should say. We have Mr. Jerry Patterson, a Texas Land Commissioner from the Texas General Land Office, and I understand Mr. Patterson would like to leave shortly afternoon to catch a flight back to the great state of Texas. We'll try to accommodate that time. And we have Mr. Brad Powell, Senior Policy Director, Sportsman's Conservation Project with Trout Unlimited. If you have not had the opportunity to testify in front of your committee, your full statement that you were asked to submit will be part of the record. But we do have a timing lights here, and we'd ask you to keep your oral remarks within the 5-minute window. And what the lights mean very simply is the green light means that you're doing very, very well, but when the yellow light goes on, you have 1 minute remaining, and ask you to kind of, conclude your remarks. And when the red light goes on, that means your 5-minute time is up. So if you can keep it within that time frame, we would very much appreciate it. And keep in mind, your full statement will be entered in the record. And with that, Lieutenant Governor Bell, you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm grateful for this opportunity and members. I note our good friend Jim Hansen, former chair, and our new member from Utah, Representative Stewart. Thank you for this opportunity. On behalf of the state of Utah and Governor Herbert, Utah was named the brightest star in the federal flag by the Wall Street Journal and the best managed state for the last several years. We appreciate the opportunity to talk about oil and gas development and concerns on federal-state relations. Let me mention that, first of all, the timing of getting through our very responsible and rigorous state process is about a fourth of the time that it takes to get a permit through BLM. Last year, we increased the number of leases significantly, and open more ground and more property for the exploration of oil and gas. We issued permits in about 79 days on average, whereas the federal government issued permits in about 307 days. So you can see it's 3 to 4 times as long. And this has been a real drag on our economy. Just for context, for instance, in the Uinta Basin, where our oil and gas is concentrated, it's a natural bowl, very sparsely populated. And I know this is outside of your jurisdiction, but we have a wintertime ozone issue, which the members from Wyoming is familiar with, which is much different than the summertime ozone in metropolitan areas. But federal rules don't allow for disparate treatment of entirely disparate problems simply because there's one chemical that's similar is treated the same. 75% of our ground is controlled by the federal government through the EPA, either Indian ground or federally owned BLM ground. Therefore, the impossibility of cooperating with the federal government, we wish to do so. We're a well-managed state. We want to improve and heighten the development responsibly of our resources, but we have a very difficult time partnering with the federal government because of the one-size-fits-all rules and because of the national policies which are not adapted to Utah's particular situation. Let me mention that in terms of hydraulic fracturing, and this, of course, is a hot issue, even making itself into the Hollywood music and pop culture, and has become an issue for not just knowledgeable laymen, but for popular culture. We have never, ever, in the state of Utah, in 30 years' experience and supervision of hydraulic fracturing, had any contamination of any groundwater whatsoever. The geology in Utah is such that our groundwater tends to be in the first 1,000 feet. Our oil and gas tend to be in much deeper layers, drilling now to 6,000, 7,000, 10,000 feet and beyond, where the intermixing opportunity for those two elements of water and oil are almost impossible, and the proof is that we've not had any contamination at all. So we'd ask you to direct your attention to that. Secondly, let me just say that the Fish and Wildlife Service has almost broken our hearts with the potential of listing the sage grouse. Since 1990, we have worked collaboratively across the spectrum trying to develop a good sage grouse preservation plan. The plan we have put forward with environmental input and the input of the service and our other federal partners would cover 94% of the sage grouse population in the state of Utah. And we had encouragement all along the way. We've been just delighted with the response to this plan, and now it threatens to be thrown out the window because of the Federal Wildlife Service. We're very disappointed in that. This to us is an extension of Wyoming's model program, which has worked so well, and we have the same geology, the same factors as Colorado and Wyoming do in this huge natural gas and oil basin, and for us now to be derailed is very, very disappointing, so we hope you'll look to that. In summary, let me just mention that we view the diversion of our oil royalty payments from federal ground through the sequester process as illegal. This is not an appropriation. This is our money that you've collected for us, and we'd appreciate the check. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Governor Bell. Appreciate your testimony. Next, we'll recognize Mr. Richard Simmers, who is the Chief of the Division of Oil and Gas Resources Management with the Ohio Department of Natural Resources. Mr. Simmers, you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Chairman Hastings and members of the Natural Resource Committee, it's an honor and a pleasure to be here to testify on this topic. My name is Rick Simmers. I'm the Chief of Ohio's Division of Oil and Gas Resources Management. I've been an employee of ODNR's Division of Oil and Gas for about 27 years. In those years, I've served as a geologist, a hydrologist, a manager, a field enforcement manager, and about a year and a half ago, I was appointed as chief of the division. When I received that appointment, Governor Kasich gathered a group of us and said that shale development as was coming to Ohio could have a significant impact on the economy of the state of Ohio. We take that very seriously, but he also cautioned that if we don't regulate this, make sure this is done properly, we'll lose the confidence of the public, and with a loss of confidence in the public, the industry could wither in Ohio. So with that in mind, we look at a number of things. You know, first of all, I think we can all agree energy development of all types, but in particular oil and gas, is both risky and sometimes dangerous. This industry needs to be regulated, and the industry is properly regulated, and I believe at the state level. Ohio has a long history of oil and gas development. First well was drilled in 1860, just a couple of months after the famous Drake well in Pennsylvania. So the second oil well drilled in this country was drilled in Ohio. There have been more than 275,000 wells drilled in our state. We have a long history of oil and gas development, and we know what we're doing. States, including Ohio, don't sit on their hands. We strive to improve our regulations all the time. We're constantly looking at our statutes and rules and evaluating problems that may arise and seeing if our statutes and rules are sufficient to address those problems. About 3 years ago, we had Ohio Senate Bill 165. It was a major change in or update in oil and gas law in Ohio. About a year after that bill was enacted, the first horizontal shale well was drilled in Ohio. So we stepped back after that well was drilled and we evaluated whether the laws, even the updated laws, were effective for the differences that this new industry was bringing to our state. Even though we have a long history, there are differences. And we found what we called a gap analysis. We saw if there were any gaps in our law that were weaknesses that we need to fill by changing the law. And there were. So we drafted statutes, we got them through and they were passed. And they were passed in approximately 8 months from drafting to enacting. We didn't do that in a vacuum though. We work with a lot of agencies. We work with partner states. Other states had had oil and gas development, the shale development, before we did. We were on the phone constantly with them for lessons learned. Other states could tell us what they did well and what they would do different if they had a do-over. So we learned from that. We listened. I read an article just this past weekend where federal regulations were characterized as uniform and consistent across the country, and state regulations were characterized as a patchwork of inconsistent laws. I couldn't disagree with that more. People that have that belief simply don't understand regulation, and they don't understand this industry. You know, the federal government and the state governments agree on a lot of things, and I'll give you one example. Time's short, so we agree on protection of people and resources. Fresh water as an example. To protect fresh water, you have to construct a well properly. So you have to have good laws on the books. You have to make sure the well's designed properly and built properly. You have to have people on the ground to make sure it occurs. We do those things. We work with other states, with associations like the Groundwater Protection Council and IOGCC to know what other states are doing. One of the things I would suggest is the states, I believe, are doing this properly. We're just doing it different. We agree on the same things that need done: protection of health and safety, protection of the environment, conservation of resources. We just go about it differently. Now, most intelligent people would agree that for any given problem, there's usually more than one solution. So I would offer that the states are just finding a different solution to the same problem. And I'll leave you with an offer and a request. I would request that the federal agencies work directly with all the state agencies so that both can benefit from the experience of each. And then I'll leave you with an offer. I welcome you to come to Ohio, and we'll show you how we regulate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chief Summers, for your testimony. Next, we'll go to Commissioner Jerry Patterson from the Texas General Land Office. And I understand Mr. Gohmert made a point that you're an A&M grad, which means you're part of the Southeastern Conference, however. Yeah. Just thought I'd point that out. And Mr. Gohmert said that was very important to him, that I make that note.
What that means,
I don't know, but you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Okay, it's code language. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. I'm Jerry Patterson. I'm the commissioner of the Texas General Land Office, which is a statewide elected position. We've had an elected land commissioner longer than we've had a governor, which gives you some indication of what interest and importance we place on public lands in the state of Texas. In addition to that, several years ago, I was the president of the Western States Land Commissioners Association, which was 23 Western states where we get together and talk about the same issues that we're talking about here. The interesting component of my job, and I want to make sure we understand that I'm the land commissioner, I'm an owner, represent the owners of a mineral and real property interest that in Texas is constitutionally dedicated to public education and higher education. Our other agency frequently involved in the oil and gas endeavor is the Railroad Commission. They are regulators, and our agency we're money makers. So we are in the business of making money, and I have a constitutionally enumerated fiduciary duty to do that. We're doing quite well in Texas. In 2012, between the University Fund, which is higher ed, and the School Fund, our revenues were $1.4 billion. Which was a record, at least in the case of our university fund. And the interesting thing about that is that almost half of that $1.4 billion were bonus royalties, which are the monies that are paid to my agency for the right to look for oil and gas. When they're successful, they pay production royalties. So our industry and the oil and gas folks are confident in a regulatory scheme that has certainty to it that they will spend, you know, one half of 1.4, so $700 million for the right to look and to take that chance. The other interesting thing is that looking at the federal land royalty rates and lease terms, it's my understanding that federal royalty rates on upland tracts are 12.5%. Our royalty rate is 25%. It's my understanding that the lease term on federal upland tracts is 5 to 10 years. Our term is 3 to 5 years. So we're charging more money and we're giving them less time, and we have a process that gives the certainty the industry needs to accept that higher royalty rate and accept a lower term and produce. I would also point out that we are not only interested in oil and gas production. The state of Texas is number one in the nation as far as installed megawatts of wind power, approximately 10,500 megawatts. The Texas General Land Office negotiated the first offshore wind lease in the United States, and we have about 250,000 acres leased in the Gulf of Mexico for wind power production. That's the good news. The bad news is, due to natural gas prices being so low, wind power is having difficulty being competitive right now. But we're confident that when natural gas prices begin to go back up, as we hope they will, that wind will be competitive and will also include more production of wind power, in addition to geothermal power. The gentleman that made the laid out the points from the minority, I believe, mentioned that, and I think I'm quoting here, our oil production is dramatically up, and that's correct, but the definition of our is extremely important. And there's a document that I perused yesterday called the Congressional Research Service. And the Congressional Research Service says overall U.S. natural gas production rose by 4 trillion feet, while production on federal lands, onshore and offshore, fell by about 23%, and production on non-federal lands grew 40%. We have an increase in non-federal land production. We have a decrease in federal land production. That's for natural gas. In the same report, in addressing oil production, it talked about the increased production from FY07 to FY12 and said all of it took place on non-federal lands. So it's very important that we define the term or when we start talking about federal lands. Bottom line is, as a fiduciary and as a head of an agency with about 550 employees that makes about $500 million a year, our motto is, if industry is not making money, we're not making money. And our money is dedicated to public education. It has tremendous public support among the voters of Texas, be they Democrat or Republican, and we're doing it correctly, just as the gentleman from Ohio enumerated about doing it correctly. We know how to do it. We hope we'd be very pleased to share our expertise and input to help the federal government do the same.
Commissioner Patterson, thank you very much for your testimony. And now I'd like to recognize Mr. Brad Powell, who is the Senior Policy Director for the Sportsman's Conservation Project of Trout Unlimited, recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman and committee members, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. My name is Brad Powell. I'm the Senior Policy Director of the Sportsman's Conservation Project for Trout Unlimited, a national nonprofit conservation organization with a mission to conserve, protect, and restore North America's cold water fisheries and their watersheds. I'm also here on behalf of Sportsmen for Responsible Energy Development, a coalition of nearly 500 organizations and companies working to find a balance between energy development and fish and wildlife conservation. As a sportsman and a longtime professional in the conservation field, I'm pleased to provide my thoughts on these important issues. My time as a federal land manager left me with a clear understanding of the need for efficient federal decision-making and permitting processes. The purpose of this hearing is to review the difference between permitting of oil and gas development on state and private lands with those on federal lands. An important distinction is that federal lands are managed for multiple uses: energy, fish, wildlife, timber, grazing, and others, whereas state and private lands generally are not. Resource uses such as energy development have to be balanced with the needs of other uses on federal lands. Many Western states have constitutional mandates requiring the managing agency to maximize revenues. On private lands, the landowners choose how to manage their lands. Thanks to the multiple use management requirements, federal lands can produce energy while also sustaining outstanding hunting and fishing opportunities. The federal lands also provide great economic opportunity from outdoor recreation, including hunting and fishing. Fiscal year 2010 saw more than 58 million recreational visits to the BLM lands, with a benefit, an economic benefit, of $7.4 billion to the economy. Our national forest had over 165 million visits, with an economic benefit of $13 billion. Hunters and anglers in the West depend on federal public lands for access to fish and wildlife. As an example, in Montana, over 75% of all hunters hunt on public lands. Similar statistics occur throughout the West. Sportsmen rely on these lands to fill their freezers, to make memories, and to pass on our traditions to our sons and daughters. Federal land managers have not always succeeded in striking a balance between energy development and other multiple uses. For example, mule deer populations have been declining in the West, and experts agree that one of the factors is winter habitat. A recent report evaluating the decline of mule deer in southwestern Wyoming and northwestern Colorado revealed that 2.4 million acres of the 10.2 million acres of mule deer crucial winter range has been leased. We're discussing permits in this hearing today. In Wyoming, another type of permit has been affected. Permits to hunt antelope in the Bitter Creek pronghorn herd unit have declined from over 3,700 to 200 in 2011, largely attributed to drilling activities. Additionally, pollution spills and stormwater runoff associated with development threatens watersheds and important trout fisheries. These impacts are avoidable through improved planning and engagement of the public. In 2010, the Department of Interior announced a set of reforms. The leasing reforms created a way to resolve potential conflicts without filing a protest. Lease protests have dropped significantly, and those from sportsmen's organizations have been reduced to a trickle. In addition, master leasing plans, when fully implemented, could provide a powerful opportunity to minimize wildlife-related and other environmental impacts. We recommend that the committee embrace constructive ideas from the states that can improve the permitting process while protecting other resource values. We also strongly recommend that the BLM be encouraged to fulfill the promise of the leasing reforms. In closing, sportsmen and women recognize the importance of energy development on public lands. We also believe in opportunities for the public to be meaningfully involved in decisions that affect the places we hunt and fish. Hunting and fishing are a part of our American heritage, a part of our way of life, and an important part of our economy. If managed appropriately for multiple uses, we can develop energy resources and ensure that our public lands remain a great place to hunt and fish. Thank you for the opportunity to testify.
Thank you very much, Mr. Powell, and thank all of you for your testimony. I'll now recognize myself for 5 minutes for questioning, and I want to ask specifically Governor Bell, Chief Simmers, and Commissioner Patterson this question. All of you have regulations that regulate hydraulic fracturing in your states. Do you believe that those regulations that your states have put in place do two things: allow for there to be an active industry in that industry, and also protect the public welfare? And Governor Bell, we'll start with you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm delighted to respond. Of course, I'm not a technical expert, but as I visit with our Division of Oil, Gas, and Mining, they explain to me the unique geology and geography in the state of Utah, which is different than that in the eastern United States. As I mentioned, we've not had one complaint or documented occurrence of pollution of any groundwater by the hydraulic fracturing method. We've been at this some 30 years. Our technicians are...
Yeah, and Governor Bell, I want to... So the short answer to your question is you feel that it does it. That's really what I want to get to, because I have other questions here. Chief Simmers.
Yeah, the simple answer is yes. We properly regulate it, and we do it quite a number of ways. I could give you detail on that if you choose. They're not oppressive. They allow companies still to have a good business. They're transparent, so companies know what to expect and how we expect them to follow the rules. So the answer is yes.
All right, Chief or Commissioner Patterson.
And as well here, the legislature in, I think, two sessions ago, well, last session, passed legislation which we believe was among the first, if not the first, regulatory schemes having to do with fracking and mandatory disclosure of the chemicals contained in fracking. Our concern in fracking is not so much the fracking itself, but the use of water Currently, 1.6 of the water demand and 1.6% of the water in Texas is used in oil and gas operations. We hope that and anticipate that'll go down to 1.3% in the near future. And I agree with the lady that I was honored to serve on a coastal recovery task force post Hurricane Ike, Lisa Jackson, when she indicated there has been no known contamination of groundwater by fracking, and we agree with that. In Texas, we have none of it either. No contamination either.
Okay, Commissioner Patterson, in your testimony, you stated that you understand that states have MOUs, memorandums of understanding, with states on the regulations of oil and gas to ensure that there is no redundancy of duplication. So you understand that those MOUs exist. Why do you think that the federal government is not reaching out to the states for MOUs on fracking?
Well, I think it, unfortunately, like anything in public discourse, sometimes issues take a life of their own that's not necessarily related to how important they are. Fracking has become a very polarizing issue, similar to the Keystone Pipeline. And it's an issue where, you know, there are demands to do something about it as if it were some new pariah. Fracking has been going on in Texas for 50 years. It's nothing new. It's a fairly routine endeavor, but for some reason it's taken a life of its own in the pop culture.
But it could because you have a precedence where there has been MOUs on the regulation. There's from your point of view, there's no reason why you couldn't have that with fracking.
Absolutely. That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Chief Simmers, you mentioned in your opening statement that Governor Kasich said that this could be good for the economy in Ohio, but you better do it right. So my question to you, in your testimony, you talked about 8 steps that you go through with every permit application on oil and gas. Do you think that the federal government would enhance that process don't want to ask a leading question, but do you think comment on whether you think the federal government would help that process or not?
In its current form, no, I don't. We have a lot of people, we have the right laws, and we have highly technical, highly trained people, and we have them located properly. We have our field staff living in and around where these wells are drilled. They are part of the public that live in the same area. They have the same interests of conservation and protection that their neighbors do. We have a very good process. We know the local geology. We work with local governments. We work with local road authorities. We can do that effectively. I don't believe the federal government could at that level.
Okay, and I assume that is always a work in progress. When you see something, there's modifications that you may make from time to time.
We're constantly looking for improvements.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Grijalva is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Part of the reason that oil companies are just sitting on tens of millions of acres of public lands, federal public lands, it's because it almost cost them nothing to do so. It cost the industry about $1.50 per acre for the first 5 years of a permit to hold the land on federal land onshore, and then $2 per acre thereafter. With that in mind, Mr. Patterson, you said in your statement that the state of Texas charges royalty rates up to 25%. That is easily twice the federal rate, yet production in Texas is robust. Do you think, as part of our discussion today and the modeling and modeling at what the states are doing, do you think we should look at increasing the federal royalty rate similar to what the levels you have in Texas?
The gentleman's question is a very good question, and it's a matter of what are you offering and then what do you expect the industry to pay. Based upon what you're offering, you may be asking too much. What we offer in Texas at 25% royalty rate, and we put competitive bids out on per acre bonuses, one-time payments, generally in the neighborhood of $100 to $1,000 per acre upfront bonus, but we offer something in return for that higher compensation that we receive. We offer certainty. We offer a permit that will be issued by a railroad commission, which, by the way, has nothing to do with railroads, but that's another story, a permit certainty that will be issued within 2 weeks. And the process is known, and in the industry is willing to risk their capital because they have certainty. So what I would suggest to you is that maybe if there was more certainty in the federal regulatory regime, you could get a higher royalty rate and higher bonus payments. Yes, sir.
So you're saying, yeah, yes, when appropriate.
I'm saying yes if the value of the commodity increased because of the regulatory certainty.
Let me follow up, if I may, sir. You also said that Texas issues leases for the length of 3 to 5 years. On public lands onshore, we issued leases for 10 years, which really means that a company can sit on these leases for 3, 7, 8, 9 years without producing. That is, I think, one of the reasons we have 25 million acres of public lands under lease onshore that are not producing. Do you think we should look at shortening the lease terms on federal lands to get companies to either use it or lose it at some point?
I think that may be something to look into once there was regulatory certainty. A company that has a lease for 10 years and takes 3 years to get a permit that may not come, or a company that has a lease
a permit.
Yeah, it's a matter of what are you offering. If you're offering certainty, then I certainly say you might take a look at shortening your lease term. We do that in Texas, and we are, as I mentioned earlier, we're getting 25%. It's because people can make money.
Would anybody else on the panel agree or disagree with Mr. Patterson's comments, both about the length of time for a lease and the royalty increase as a modeling tool for getting more production out of federal lands? That was kind of a qualified when appropriate. And, sir?
Well, I would only say, Representative, that it defies the laws of economics that oil companies would sit on federal leases when diesel is at $4 and gas is at $3.50. They have every economic incentive to develop oil and gas. So many of these leases are just not productive.
Sir?
I would only follow that Ohio law says that once a company goes in, they have to conserve a resource. They don't waste the resource. Part of that waste means once you go in to develop, you develop efficiently and completely. So if you're going to develop, develop. Begin it, make sure it's done properly, efficiently. And
in your regulatory, Ohio's regulatory process, that incentive for producing effectively and efficiently is there.
Yeah, and we have a new leasing process that can set the terms of a lease on state properties.
Thank you. Sir, no comment.
Mr. Grijalva, I think we believe in the conservation community that the 7,000 or so leases that are currently being held is an indication of speculation, often, I think, has been mentioned here. And that there should be incentive to develop those leases once they're obtained.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think Mr. Petter has shown that Texas has many provisions that would be good models for federal land and increase the return to taxpayers and get the companies that are warehousing and speculating to either use or lose those leases, and that others that want to produce have an opportunity to produce. With that, I yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes Dr. Fleming from Louisiana.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Bell, you indicated the difference between the permitting time for federal land versus private land. I talk with drillers in my state of Louisiana, and they tell me that private land is typically 3 days to get a private permit, at least a year to get a federal permit, and the cost is considerably more. The paperwork, the bureaucracy is a lot more. So I certainly agree with your experience in Utah that it's a very different process there. Gentlemen, Secretary Salazar was here last year and the director of BLM, and I asked these questions point blank about hydraulic fracturing, which we all know is 50 to 60 years old technology, has been around, proven safe, And then, of course, now we have directional horizontal drilling. And to my surprise, he was very candid and honest about this. Not once has a human ever been harmed or killed as a result of the process. And there has never been documentation of groundwater contamination. Now, having said that, in my state, and I think as yours, we have state regulators. They're crawling all over the place, making sure that the process is done correctly. It's just unbelievable to me that we've got to now add a whole nother layer of regulation from the federal government for a non-problem. Don't we have many other problems, gentlemen? And Mr. Bell, I'd love to hear your comment on that.
We certainly don't want to go back to 19th century economic and ecological devastation. We don't have ground in Utah to throw away. Mm-hmm. We don't throw it away. Prime Minister Cameron said we're in the middle of nowhere. And sometimes it feels like that. We're a big state with arid areas, but we don't throw ground away. We preserve it. Production of oil on private ground and state ground is up 100% since 2008. On federal ground, 4%. That just tells the story. Mm-hmm. And we're very diligent about fracturing, and again, we've had the same experience of no contamination.
Yes, sir. And Mr. Patterson, you made the comment, and I agree with you on this, that despite what we've heard from the president and from the other side of the aisle, that in fact, energy production has been down on federal lands. The president bragged about how under his administration, production of conventional energy has been way up, and he's right about that, and the reason is because a part of America that he can't put the heavy boot of the federal government on its neck is the private sector, and that's where all the growth is coming from. I'd love to hear your response.
Well, and yes, sir, that's correct, and I think the document that I just had an opportunity to look at, dated 7 March 2013 by the Congressional Research Service, as I laid out, enumerates that all of this production increase has been occurring on non-federal lands, while at the same time, both in oil and natural gas, there's a decrease on federal lands. And the reason for that is it's not economic. If we make it economic for industry, they will pay more, and they will do it right. But it's not necessarily for the purpose of getting to pay more. It's to produce the resource so we can continue severing our connection to foreign energy, which is important to me. I have a son who's a veteran of four terms. He's a Marine. Four tours overseas duty. So we talk about this, you know, our interest in other parts of the world in part driven to some extent by our economic interests having to do with hydrocarbon energy. So there's more reasons to produce domestic energy than just the money.
Right. And there was a little bit of discussion, and we hear this from the other side of the aisle constantly, is, well, if a driller leases a certain amount of property, then they shouldn't have any more leases until they drill on that. But my understanding, the experts tell me that it's best to drill where the oil and gas actually is.
It pays better.
And so, you know, if you could find out where it is first and then lease it, that would be really neat. But until we're able to do that, until we perfect that technology, I would suggest to you that there's still going to be some land out there that's leased that's never drilled on.
Exactly. Even at $1.50 an acre, that could be a ripoff for whoever paid that when they go out there and find out, oops, we just got had. There's nothing here.
Right, absolutely. Now, Mr. Powell, you made an interesting statement. You're saying that with all the drilling that's going on in certain parts of America that we're destroying habitat and we're seeing a direct response among, I forget what you said, whether it was antelope or deer, I forget what it was. Again, the Haynesville Shale, which is arguably the largest deposit of natural gas in America, or North America, actually, we have, you know, hundreds, maybe thousands of pads out there where we've drilled, and they're very small and very limited, and we don't see any impact. And I apologize, but it looks like my time is up. I'll yield back, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. We do have a lot of interest in this, and Mr. Powell, if you would respond to that in writing, I'd appreciate it very much because it is an important question. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Cartwright.
Thank you, Chairman Hastings and Ranking Member Grijalva, for your leadership in bringing this hearing before the committee. And I also want to thank our witnesses for agreeing to come here today. Protecting our environment and ensuring an efficient and thorough regulatory process is one of my top priorities in Congress, and I'm glad to be delving into this topic here today. The raw data certainly indicate drilling and production is more robust today than ever before. 2012, as Ranking Member Grijalva mentioned, represented America's highest level of oil production in 20 years, while natural gas reached its highest level in the nation's history. These advances played a large role in America's decreased reliance on foreign fuels, which is at its lowest level since 1988. These steps toward an energy-independent America are promising, and this growth can be attributed in part to the federal government's improving efficiency. During President Obama's first term, the administration approved more drilling permits than during President Bush's first term, and federal processing time for applications for permits to drill have decreased by 19% since then. It seems in some ways that the federal regulators are outpacing the industry's ability to develop. There are currently 7,000 approved permits that have not been utilized, covering an area of land approximately the size of Kentucky. Now, as oil and gas drilling become more prevalent, the risks posed by the industry increase, and we have Chief Simmers here, and I appreciated your comments, sir, and I don't think anyone would disagree with you when you said that the oil and gas drilling is both risky and dangerous. We do need strong regulation to protect ourselves from ecological disasters, and there's no doubt, Chief Simmers, that some states in some areas have stepped up to do a great job at regulating the industry in a fair, reasonable, and expeditious manner. And I understand that states currently doing a good job at all of that would feel put out by the idea of federal regulations superseding the good work that they're already doing. Now, that makes sense. But many states have failed to safeguard the environment, and the country has become a patchwork of regulations which does not serve anyone's interest. The federal government has a distinct role here for several reasons. First, pollution doesn't obey state borders. Water flows and air goes between states, meaning one state's lax regulations can negatively impact the environment of a neighboring state. Second, not all states have the expertise or the money to research and implement effective regulations, and why reinvent the wheel 50 times and go through 50 state legislations when standards can be set at the national level. Finally, I believe having uniformity can help industry so they have a standard set of expectations and guidelines to follow. Unfortunately, too many loopholes exist in current federal statutes relating to the oil and gas industry. Now, I'm from the great Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, which is one of the epicenters of the recent rise in hydraulic fracturing. Now, my constituents and those in neighboring districts know very well the potential impacts of this practice if it is not properly regulated. We did have a mishap in March in Wyoming County, Pennsylvania, where hundreds of thousands of gallons of fracking fluid escaped. I came to Congress to protect the health and property of my constituents and their environment. Mr. Powell mentioned stormwater runoff as a particular pollution issue having to do with oil and gas extraction. And that's why my first bill as a congressman was the Fresher Act this year, which subjects oil and gas companies to the same regulations on stormwater runoff that every other industry is required to observe. Additionally, I'm planning on introducing a bill in the coming months to ensure that the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, which focuses on the disposal of particularly hazardous waste, also applies to the oil and gas industry. See no reason why a single industry should be exempted from these landmark environmental bills, and I will work to make sure that everybody plays by the same safe, reasonable, and fair rules. I look forward to working with my colleagues on this committee to improve regulations while allowing our industry to flourish. And with that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Flores.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. I'm going to go through, and I'd like, if you can, give me short answers so I can get as much done in the next 5 minutes as possible. Governor Bell, starting with you, have you heard of any problems with hydraulic fracturing within the boundaries of Utah? Okay. What are your reflections? This is going to impact you more than anybody else, but as you know, the BLM is getting ready to issue its own set of hydraulic fracturing regulations. What do you think about that? What do you think the impact would be on the economy in your state? Well, and oil and gas activities.
It takes 8 years for us to negotiate NEPA. We had 7 years of resource management plans the BLM helped us develop, which were tossed by Interior when this new administration came in. You overlay that with federal regulation on fracking, and this is going to devastate our industry.
Do you think that Utah has been treated differentially versus Wyoming and Colorado with respect to the potential listing of the sage grouse?
Yes, I don't know the comparison with Colorado, but certainly Wyoming had a voluntary plan, which is a model plan, and we're on the cusp of that, and now apparently are not going to be able to bring it home.
We'll probably want to come back and visit with you on that at some point in the future. Do you see that, you've got state land that's managed, you've seen the federal government manage 75% of the land within your border. Do you think the federal government manages its land any better than the state of Utah manages it?
Well, it's joked that it's not under new management, it's under no management.
Okay, that's good. And with respect to protection of critical habitat, do you think that the federal government does it any better today than the state government of Utah does?
I think not. I've done a lot of land planning. We've had a wonderful land bill in one of our counties, which has worked extraordinarily well, negotiated by all parties. And we're very proud of our record. In 1995, we had $95 million in our state trust lands, school trust. We now have $1.5 billion.
That's impressive. Mr. Simmers, one of the metrics you didn't talk about was the permit timing differences of the state versus the federal government, or if you did, I missed it. And we're talking about 307 days on average for a drilling permit issuance for federal lands. What is it for the state of Ohio?
In the state of Ohio, our permitting is mandated by law. We can't issue a permit sooner than 10 days. And for certain permits, they have to be issued within 21 days, others 30 days.
So what's the average, roughly?
Average about 13.
13, okay. So 307 days for the federal government versus 13 days. I assume that it has a big economic impact on your state. I mean, you don't have that much federal land within your borders, but I mean, theoretically, it would be huge for the return to the taxpayer on this important taxpayer-owned asset.
Yes.
Your experience with hydraulic fracturing, I think you addressed. Can you tell me again, have you had any issues in the state of Ohio with hydraulic fracturing?
Ohio's had hydraulic fracturing going on since about 1952. Some 80,000 wells have been fractured.
Okay.
Not one incident in groundwater contamination.
One of the things you said was particularly enlightening for me, and you talked about how Ohio addressed the regulatory process, and you'd used the term gap analysis, which is what we use. When I came from the real world, we use gap analysis to determine how do you draw up a set of procedures or processes for anything. So based on what you've seen of the federal regulatory process, have you ever seen them use gap analysis or just some wild whim to address the regulatory scheme?
Frankly, I don't know how they're doing it. We haven't been involved in
okay.
it or asked to be involved.
That answers my question for me. And then do you see any advantages to the way federal land in Ohio is managed versus the way Ohio manages its state property?
We all have the same goal, protection of people and the environment. We're there, we have the numbers, we have the resources, including the financial wherewithal to get it done, and I think that's all we need.
Okay. And Commissioner Patterson, I think you addressed the issue of hydraulic fracturing very well when you talked about Lisa Jackson, former EPA administrator, said we've got no issues, that we've had no problems with that in the past, so I won't ask you that question. Do you see any differences in terms of the quality of the way the state manages state land versus the way the federal government manages federal land in the state? Now, I realize in Texas we don't have that much federal land. You've got about 12 seconds.
Okay, well, what I see is the anecdotal reports, and not only anecdotal reports, from my counterparts in those states in the West who do have federal land. And clearly the state model is superior.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. Now I yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Nevada, Mr. Horsford.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the panel. It's, you know, good to hear from state-level experts, you know, who are dealing with this issue, you know, every day. And, you know, I've got to say that I think that the answer really is somewhere in the middle. I think, based on my experience in Nevada, having worked both as a state legislator and in the private sector, that there is a need to better partner and coordinate with our state agencies in this regard. I think that it's unacceptable that BLM takes as long as it does to permit certain projects. And I have expressed that for some time now. And I hope that we can work together on both sides of the aisle to find strategies that will improve, you know, what agencies are doing. I will note that, you know, sometimes it sounds as if the critique is that it's this administration that somehow, though, is the fault here. And under this administration, the days for permitting projects has improved. The length of time to take the approval has improved, and the number of permits has improved. So, you know, let's just state the facts as the facts, and then we can deal with the root of the problem, which is trying to get as many of the projects that are ready, that do protect the environment, that do protect our lands, approved and under development. So I would like to ask, you know, my question around the areas of what you're seeing at the state level on the budget impacts under sequestration and what that may mean to their ability of carrying out this function. The Department of the Interior is expected to see an 8.2% cut. So I'm interested to know whether cuts in funding would have a negative impact on the ability of federal agencies to review and properly permit the development of, you know, energy production, you know, from your perspective. And Mr. Lieutenant Governor, if you could go first.
Thank you, Congressman. And coming from a state which is probably has more federal land than any other state, you understand what we're dealing with. We have many drillers who have said, we're just pulling up stakes, we're going to Texas and North Dakota where it's private land because we just can't deal with the regulation. Part of the problem with BLM has simply been a manpower issue. So depending on how these cuts are deployed, it will make a major difference in terms of getting boots on the ground to respond to applications.
The other witnesses, quickly, please.
Ohio has little federal land, but we do have primacy in our injection control program through US EPA. We receive some funding for that. I haven't seen any change in that funding based on sequestration, but the funding's very limited in general anyway. We get about $170,000 to run a $1.3 million UIC program in Ohio. We make up the difference. So I would see funding as a problem in general, not necessarily related to sequestration.
You know, as far as we have minimal, if any, I'm trying to think of what BLM land we have in Texas, and I don't think we have any. However, the Department of Interior, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, which is required to make a statutory response to endangered species nominations in a 12-month period, that's a statutory problem. It's not a personnel problem. We have issues with ESA and the fact that fish is being, you know, covered up with applications and nominations for ESA is the problem. But it's a statutory, not a personnel problem, so I don't think sequester has anything to do with it.
So in Ohio and Texas, what is the focus on renewable energy production in your states?
Renewables encouraged in Ohio. I don't know the exact standard, but in the Public Utility Commission, the electric regulators have a certain amount of renewable energy that has to be achieved within their organizations, I believe by the year 2020. So there's an emphasis on it, and I believe it's 20%.
Texas, we have a renewable portfolio standard, 5,880 megawatts, which we surpassed that several years ago.
I would hope that renewables can continue to be part of this discussion, again, in recognition that in Nevada, at least 87% or thereabouts of our land is controlled by the federal government.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Montana, Mr. Daines.
Thank you, Chairman Hastings. I was trained as a chemical engineer in college, and one thing I'm trained to do is look at data and hopefully come to objective conclusions. I just would like to state I'm hearing a lot of talking points, perhaps, about the increase in oil and gas production, but the purpose of this hearing is to contrast the public lands, federal lands, versus state lands, and I think the data is compelling. It's very clear from the testimony here, there is a wide disparity between what's going on our federal lands versus our state and private lands. I come from the state of Montana. We have 27 million acres of federal lands. This is a big issue for us as we look at the potential to balance. And I appreciate the comments from Mr. Powell. I'm a sportsman. I'm a fifth-generation Montanan. My favorite passion is hunting antelope and fly fishing. So I and most Montanans, I think, get that and want to strike a balance between conserving the great state that we have, but also having jobs so we can live there and not have to travel to California to see the grandkids. For Lieutenant Governor, how do federal efforts to regulate hydraulic fracturing affect the local community's control of their own mineral development?
Let me just say in quick preface, the most devastating thing the federal government has done to us is all our natural resource counties came together and developed resource management plans over a 7-year process. It was an absolutely painstaking effort, gathering everyone around the table, 360-degree process, just a wonderful outcome. Everyone was singing and happy, and then Interior tossed them and started over. So those kinds of things are just break economies and break business plans. Now, fracking, we don't understand the reason for the suggestion for new regulation. We haven't had a problem, so it's difficult to understand the impetus for this.
Commissioner Patterson, do you have a thought on that too?
We see no reason to regulate an activity that's not creating any kind of problem, and fracking is not creating any kind of problem.
Yeah, we always say in Montana the two biggest lies in Montana is when somebody from Washington, D.C. comes and says, we're here to help. And they said the next biggest lie is when we say, we're glad you're here. I applaud our oil and gas groups that are back in Montana who are getting ahead of this, getting the regulations out at the state level here to regulate, because we think that a one-size-fits-all is a one-size-that-fits-nobody. And maybe having said that, is we think of differences in geology and standards. You could maybe expand, maybe Lieutenant Governor, maybe the Commissioner, around how a one-size-fits-all really is one-size-fits-none.
I would make the Western States Land Commissioners Association, we pool our information. We plagiarize from each other. You know, there are states that are new to oil and gas production that come to Texas and say, what do you suggest? And we tell them, well, here's what we suggest. It might work better if you did it another way. There is already an active exchange of information among these Western producing states that, you know, belies the need for any federal regulation. We got it. We know where to get the information if we don't have it, and we're working together. Utah, Texas, Wyoming, Nevada, all of us are doing quite well.
If there's one thing that you could say we could take away we needed to do to accelerate development, responsible development on our federal lands, what would that one thing be?
I would suggest certainty. The industry needs to know what the rules are, and they need to know what they're going to have to do, and that needs to be definitive and certain before they make any commitment.
Okay. I want to shift gears sage grouse for a moment. And Mr. Patterson, we understand the issuance of an APD is really the last step in that permitting process. before an APD is issued, the BLM must check a lot of boxes, the NEPA review, consultation with Fish Wildlife Services, endangered species, and so forth. Many of our mineral reserves are on BLM land or Forest Service lands, and there's this looming potential listing here of the sage-grouse. Montana's home of a lot of sage-grouse habitat. It's a concern for a lot of Montanans about this potentially being put in the ESA. Let me ask, what can you expand on the significance of some of these plans that are being developed at the moment in terms of the sage-grouse habitat and protection?
In Texas, we're more concerned with other species than sage-grouse, most recently the dune sagebrush lizard, but they're all part of the movement by several environmental groups to cover up fish and wildlife with applications they can't respond to. Sage-grouse is not high on our radar right now. Right now, it's the prairie chicken.
I guess I'm out of time.
Time of the
gentleman. Thank you. Yep.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair recognizes the gentleman from California, Mr. Huffman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a question, but before I get to it, I just want to mention that this is not the first time we've had a hearing that delves into this issue. It's beginning to feel like a movie that I've seen before. We come together, and there's this narrative about the heavy boot of government on the neck of the poor oil and gas industry, and yet that narrative keeps bumping up against some fairly unmovable realities, the fact that production is up under this administration, the fact that, frankly, times have never been better. If it's a heavy boot, it's not a very effective boot because we keep hearing from the majority party's own witnesses that, frankly, the oil and gas business is booming. So happy to see this movie once again and happy to arrive at the familiar ending. But I do have a question that might bring a little light to the subject. We're seeing some studies that are suggesting there are big differences between the states on fugitive methane emissions. And I don't know if all of the witnesses are familiar with this. An example is a University of Colorado study done in conjunction with NOAA that recently measured fugitive methane emissions from natural gas fields in the West. And they found, for example, fugitive emissions of 4% in Colorado, but 9% in Utah. So it's suggesting that there are some real differences between the states, Utah having a higher leakage rate than Colorado. This is methane gas, which is obviously a very powerful greenhouse gas that we need to be concerned about. And certainly this would suggest, at least to me, that there's a role for the federal government to ensure that standards are in place throughout the West. And that we're doing everything we can to prevent these fugitive emissions. So I would just ask the witnesses, starting with Mr. Powell, what you are doing to take a look at this problem and what its implications would be. And perhaps from the gentleman from Utah, if you feel like your state is doing everything it can to get on top of this and what you might say to the difference between Colorado and Utah on fugitive emissions.
Specific to fugitive emissions, my organization's not working on that, but I do think your point that it points out that there are significant areas of concern, that's just one of them, that we think require some type of monitoring and management, particularly on federal lands, to ensure that they're done adequately. We don't think state regulations are doing that in all cases today.
I don't have the technical expertise to comment on it, and I'd be happy to submit written response to that, other than to say we're also dealing with this problem in non-resource-ish areas, agricultural areas, where there's a methane issuance from cattle flatulence. We have to be aware of those things. So we'll have
a cattle flatulence hearing, I'm sure, at some point this year, and we'll all look forward to that. But I'm asking about the fracking and oil and gas development that we're here to discuss today. What did you have anything to explain the difference between you?
Well, I mentioned that I'd be happy to submit a technical answer to that.
Thanks. I'll yield back, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yield to me before he yields back? The gentleman yield to me before he yields back?
Absolutely.
I'm glad the gentleman is appreciating what he characterized as a rerun here, but there's a reason for this. Then I think Mr. Daines pointed it out. There is a huge, huge difference of regulatory, results on state and federal lands. And this is simply a hearing to point that out. Now, I make no bones that I am an all-of-the-above energy person. And nobody has asked any of the witnesses if there are the same problems with regulatory regulations from the federal government on green energy. And I suspect if that question were to be asked, they'd say, yes, there is. It's just like an oil and gas. The point is in our best interest as a country, from my point of view, to be as energy independent as we possibly can. And if we have one sector of our economy that is experiencing growth because of lack of regulation, and yet the public welfare is still being taken care of, then we ought to look at that. And that is simply what this hearing really is all about, is to ascertain that. Now, the more information we get, the better we can make determinations. But in the larger picture, I just think, and I think most Americans think, from a national security standpoint, it is best for us to be as energy independent as we possibly can. And I thank the gentleman for yielding.
Thank you, Mr. In the final 10 seconds, if I might,
Your time.
I respect where you're coming from there, Mr. Chair. I just also hope we keep in mind that in many respects, public and private lands and federal and state lands really are apples and oranges, ranging from the geographical coincidences of where the shale is to the multiple management objectives that exist on federal lands that don't exist on those other lands. And if with that context...
Your time has expired. I would just simply say that the gentleman points out why sometimes one-size regulations fits all don't work. With that, I recognize the gentleman from North Dakota, Mr. Kramer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and ranking member, and a very, very good panel of witnesses. Thank you all very much. And I have to admit, multiple times now since I've been in Congress, and I'm a freshman from North Dakota, multiple times I've heard the president take credit or imply credit for the America's booming oil production, and every time he says it, I find myself saying, you're welcome. I think this is a worthwhile endeavor to explore the differences between state and federal regulation, but I share some of the concerns of my friends on the other side, and sometimes think we don't articulate it very well, that federal land is different, not just geographically, but in its ownership, that a single rancher, a single owner of land in western North Dakota, a rancher, has a little more liberty to do with his land what he wants than our responsibility on behalf of over 300 million people, and I think we're all sensitive to that and probably don't speak to it often enough. And the multiple uses. While I was a regulator, an energy regulator in North Dakota for 10 years, at one point I was the tourism director for North Dakota. So I have an appreciation for all the uses of our public lands. I hate to take issue with a witness as distinguished as a lieutenant governor, but I did want to correct the record that in this year's Wall Street analysis, North Dakota was deemed the best run state. But it is the first time. It is the first time. But we were also surprisingly, we have the distinction this year by the Mercatus Center as being the freest state in the nation as well. And I think that might explain why for the last five of the last 6 years, North Dakota has the distinction of having the fastest personal per capita income growth in the nation as well. But we're also a state that meets all ambient air quality standards as prescribed by the EPA. We love our land and our water and our air much more than federal regulators do. Having said that, there was just a couple of things I wanted to touch on with regard to especially a question. Somebody referenced earlier, and it might have been the ranking member in his opening statement, that after completed application, there's a distinction about the permit time before, quote, completed application and perhaps from the beginning of the process, if you will. And I think that's an important distinction. A completed application, if somebody could help me understand that, is that further complicated? That is to say that getting to completion of an application, is that further complicated by regulation? And do the complexities of regulation extend the time it takes to even prepare an application? If
may I respond? Thank
yes.
you. You may be quoting another study, but the Pew names us as the best managed state, and so we'll have to duke that out later, I guess. But I'm glad you're doing well. there are really three levels of regulation from the federal government, and you don't have as much federal ground, and your production is not on federal ground for the most part, I understand. But ours is. So number one, you have the entire NEPA process. So to open a field and start talking about leases and production is the NEPA and the clean water and environmental impact level. Then you have the leasing bidding thing, and the Department of Interior canceled 77 leases in the state of Utah when it came into office, which was highly disturbing to industry because that's the uncertainty that makes capital a coward. And so then you go through all this leasing regime. Then the third level is once you have a lease and in a cleared area, then you have to apply for a permit. And that's the 307 days we're talking about. So that's the tail end of the process.
Thank you. That's an important distinction to anybody else.
I might just add to that. I think what the ranking member was discussing in the 307 days, there's actually two processes underway. One is the BLM processing time, and the other is the industry permit development time, or the time they take to fill it out. In the last 5 years, the processing time has declined by the BLM from over 100 days to 71 days, while the industry permit filling out period of time has increased.
Thank you. A very good distinction, and that's really what I wanted to get to, because while it may appear, and I agree, and by the way, BLM in North Dakota is fantastic. We really have very little argument with the people on the ground. But there is the additional work for industry itself to get to that point that is a product of regulation. Other than that, I guess, and my time has expired, but I would at some point want to continue the discussion on how we did talk about exporting our natural resources. But I'll yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Oregon, Mr. DeFazio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So we've heard a discussion of certainty and consistency, and I want to raise a question that relates to that. Number of states have varying regulations on the books for environment public health. Wyoming requires pre-fracking disclosure of all hydraulic fracturing chemicals. That would allow both the operator to do a baseline in the area and prove they didn't cause a problem if it happens, because people know what chemicals they used. It also gives the state and or affected individuals an opportunity to track. Colorado, West Virginia require a notice of fracking to adjacent landowners. I don't know whether Ohio does, whether you get those whole 13 days to issuance a permit to respond. In the state of Texas, there are rules for intermediate and production casing cementing. Now, think Macondo. Seems like a pretty important thing, especially if you're going through a water table, which might even be interstate, to get to the gas deposits. It seems kind of a no-brainer. You want to test that, but a lot of other states don't require that. New Mexico, there are tight restrictions on wastewater pits. Think hurricanes on the East Coast. Think about other severe weather events in the Midwest. Earthquakes, whether they're induced or not, might be a pretty good idea to have some regulation that's on wastewater pits. And then my colleague from California raised the idea of fugitive methane, something which can be prevented and controlled, and whether we measure it in cow equivalents or percentage, it's something we could deal with. So my question would be, and I'll start with Mr. Powell, is it, you know, we hear a lot about, you know, certainty and consistency, and how do fracking rules and regulations that vary from state to state provide that kind of certainty and consistency, both to the industry and to the potentially affected public?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. The fracking rules in this country are all over the board. There are some states that still have moratoriums on it. So I think, particularly when it comes to disclosure of the chemicals that are used and the whole integrity or the well integrity, that there should be some basic standards on public lands that should be followed. Currently, that's not done when you look at the variety of state regulations across the country.
Okay, anybody else want to comment on why having this sort of inconsistency benefits the industry?
Yeah, I would. Fracking rules point to the end of a well. After you construct a well, you go in and complete a well. That's a particular operation. Fracking rules only identify the tail end of that portion of a well as it's being constructed and readied.
But wouldn't that include testing the casing and the cementing?
It could.
Well, shouldn't it, don't you think?
In Ohio, it does.
Good. That's great.
But
some states don't have that rule, and it seems to me a pretty basic thing. We went through Macondo. Why would we want to repeat that on an interior portion of the U.S.?
I would agree with you, and we have to have comprehensive rules that address from the very beginning at the permitting process. You have to assure proper well construction. It's a holistic approach. It's not a single approach.
Okay,
thing that
you can agree on that. So the question is, what if the government just established a baseline, and in any state that has casing requirements, you're exempt. Any state that has inadvertent methane escape requirements, you're exempt. Any state that has requirements on disclosing the chemicals used, you're exempt. But we set a floor because there are some states that are choosing not to take the steps that apparently Ohio has taken, perhaps because it's a more populated state.
As long as the standards are good, we received a survey from US EPA recently for fugitive gas. US EPA is trying to analyze production in states. They sent us a survey. The model that was used for the survey is so flawed, it was ridiculous. When we worked with the US EPA staff that sent us the thing, gave them the actual numbers. For example, the number of compressors that are used for compression. The number that they had put in for Ohio was ridiculous.
Okay, but I mean, if we just went to a, like, we don't want the inadvertent escape as, I mean, I have impatience with the bureaucracy around here many times on many issues.
Okay.
And, you know, but I mean, if we kind of can get to a, if we could get to a common sense rule that deals with these problems that was a floor, and states that are already have something higher or equivalent or exempt, would that wouldn't impede the industry, right?
I think we should get to common sense. I said in my testimony that I think the federal and state governments need to work together. We should be sharing information. We do need to work together.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Quickly, 13 seconds. Nope, okay. All right, thank you.
Would the gentleman yield to me real quickly?
Oh, yep, sure.
I don't know if you were here when I had my questions, but in Mr. Commissioner Patterson's testimony, he said that there are MOUs on other regulations. And I posit the question, why couldn't there be an MOU on fracking? And I don't want to put words in Commissioner Patterson's mouth, but I think he responded by saying because it may be more politically hot than otherwise. But the point is there's no reason why you couldn't have that collaboration because you have collaboration right now with MOUs. The big question is a political hot topic, and I know way over time here. Thank the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Tipton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, panel, for being here today. Mr. Patterson, I think you'd noted that your son, I believe you said, was a four-tour Marine veteran. Is that right?
That's correct.
Thank him for his service, by the way, and thank you for your family. Part of the issue that you brought up on that is part of our engagement is actually to be able to meet some of the energy needs of our nation that we're probably elsewhere in the world. If we look at the United States right now, are we energy self-sufficient?
No, but I think there's a possibility within 20 or 30 years we might be.
So it's in the interests of this country to be able to develop American resources on American soil, putting Americans back to work, to be able to create that energy certainty.
Absolutely.
Would you agree with that? I think this is really an important point that we need to be looking at. We haven't achieved that even with increased development, primarily on our public lands. To be able to achieve that ultimate goal of creating American self-sufficiency when it comes actually to be able to have real energy. That involves the responsible development on our public lands. And it seems to me that, and I'd like you to be able to speak to this if you might, the issue that we're addressing here is when we're looking at the Department of Interior rules potentially coming out of one size fits all. And perhaps the governor, Lieutenant Governor out of Utah and Mr. Simmers would like to speak to this as well. Is the geology different from state to state?
Absolutely. Geology and other factors may cause laws to need to differ.
Would you agree with that, Lieutenant Governor?
I'm not, a technical expert, but they tell me that less than 2% of all wells drilled annually are shallower than 1,000 feet in Utah. That's where our groundwater commonly is found. And so with horizontal drilling and the deep wells, we're well below 5,000 feet. So that is in part an explanation why we've not had an event.
Right. So the lands in Utah are different than they're going to be in Ohio versus Texas versus New York. So one size fits all really doesn't work, does it?
I wouldn't say so. Shale is different. It's not the same in every state.
Right.
The porosity, whether, you know, what degree of frack, and I'm not a petroleum engineer, but shale is different in different states, so therefore fracking needs and requirements might very well also be different.
And to get a little bit specific, I come from the state of Colorado. In fact, the oil and gas regulations which have been implemented in our state have been held up as a standard for many other states perhaps to be able to implement. But it's in recognition that they are tailored to the state of Colorado. So, gentlemen, given your experience, do you believe that the federal government is ready to be able to address the unique concerns in your state with a one-size Washington knows best and fits all program?
I gave the example earlier of where our natural resources are located. It needs common management between state agencies and federal agencies because of the prescriptive nature of the Clean Air Act. The EPA, even if they were willing, cannot cooperate with state government on some reasonable basis to regulate summer or wintertime ozone, which is a completely unique problem. And that, to me, is a perfect analogy of there's rarely flexibility in federal rules that would allow that, so we're very, very nervous about that.
Great.
As Ohio worked to modify our laws, as we did our gap analysis, we were finding those weaknesses in law. We didn't work in a vacuum. We called states. Colorado was one of the states we called. We talked to them frequently. We thought many of their statutes were very good. Now, they didn't quite fit the Ohio need, but we took the basic structure of some of the Colorado laws and modified them so they worked in Ohio. We didn't reinvent the wheel, we just made that wheel fit Ohio.
You know, one issue I'd like, and we're gonna run out of time here, is the impact that federal regulations can have on private lands, energy development, and job creation. With the sage grouse issue, with prairie chicken, with your lizard down in Texas, do you have a concern that an overreaching program that isn't taking consideration state programs for endangered species is going to inhibit jobs and energy creation in your states?
We have a completed plan ready to go, agreed, signed off by private property owners, county, state trust lands, and apparently it's going to be upset by this pending designation.
Time of the gentleman has expired.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes the gentlelady from New Hampshire, Mrs. Shea Porter.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I have a question for Mr. Powell. Despite the claims of the majority, isn't it true that the draft proposed BLM hydraulic fracturing rule would not be a duplicative layer of regulation, but would rather be implemented by individual state BLM offices, not on top of existing state standards, but rather in a way that dovetails with them and would create a federal floor for public land?
Yeah, I think that's true. Now, as you well know, the draft has been withdrawn, so now there's a new draft being developed, and we've not seen that yet. But we think the original draft was intended to set a floor to try and allow states to add additional layers to that floor if they thought it was necessary, and it included a couple of key things. One, it included disclosure of chemicals, and we think that that's just common sense, that the public surrounding these lands that are developed should have an understanding of what chemicals are used. And the second deals with integrity of the well itself to ensure, I think as was mentioned earlier, that there's not leakage of fluids during the drilling operation or in the storage of those fluids. And we think those are essential components. Some states have some regulation that tries to deal with that, but it's very inconsistent at this point. And maybe one last thing I'd point out is those regulations are only intended for public lands, federal public lands.
Right, so why do you think we have the confusion about this? It seems to be that so many people believe that this will, you know, be as I first stated. What's the problem out there between the state and the federal government right now?
My own opinion is that it's driven more by industry than it is the individual states, that the industry itself is very concerned about what they view as additional regulation, And quite frankly, they believe that they have more ability to influence the state regulators than they do federal regulators. When you look at the East, where you actually have moratoriums in place, I don't think that is shown to be true in some of those states.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Bell, could you please tell me, please, we've all seen the YouTube video of faucets and the water flames coming out of them. We know there have been problems in different areas about fracking. Do you think there should be some national standards? Do you think the EPA has some role in protecting the individuals there? And what are you doing in your state?
Well, I suppose that you can talk about the need for federal regulation if you can identify the problem. In Utah, we don't have a problem identified, so I don't understand the impetus why Utah would be included in such a regime.
All right, so when we talk about the industry, and then we talk about individuals, and we talk about the responsible role of government, and I think I'll address this to Mr. Simmers. What happens to individuals, what do you think should happen to citizens of your states if they find out that fracking has indeed caused a problem? Say they do show up with a YouTube of water coming out. Who's liable? Should there be liability there? And what do you think the rights of the individuals are in this circumstance?
Ohio law already protects the individual rights. Our agency in the Division of Oil and Gas within ODNR in Ohio has a statute in place that says if an individual is impacted, then the company is liable. And we are the ones that investigate that. We cause an action based on whatever the facts may show. And if it shows that a company has indeed caused a problem, then we work with the property owner and the company to get that resolved. And it can take many forms. We can create escrow accounts. We can do property valuations. We can have remediation plans in place. It can take many forms. We already do that.
And yet we've seen many individuals saying that they have not been helped, that in spite of the fact that these rules are in place, that they have felt abandoned, and that's why they put their video up there so people can see actually the problem there. So how do you explain that gap there?
Many people don't understand the cause of a problem. If you technically look at the cause of a problem, gas in a water supply as an example, there's a lot of natural gas in very shallow groundwater aquifers naturally before any oil and gas wells were drilled. That could be mapped easily. In Ohio, in Trumbull County, there's an oil field that's only 30 feet deep. In the 1880s, there were 2,000 wells drilled in a 30-foot deep oil field.
Let me interrupt here for a moment. So you're saying that people have had fire coming out of their water forever, and we just happened to recently notice and start taking videos of it?
No, what I'm saying is people may not understand what the actual cause of a problem is.
Yeah, but I'm asking you that, are you saying, and we're not talking about the cause, are you saying that the circumstances have been happening all along, that what I hear you saying is it could be natural causes. Mm-hmm. And if it is natural causes, how come we haven't seen videos of people getting fire out of their faucets before fracking?
There hasn't been attention on it before.
Well, I think people would notice if they had fire coming out and might want to share that problem.
You would think
thank
so.
You. Thank you. I yield back.
Well, I'd like to remind the representative there are historical cases like that where it was in there all along. And Mr. Summers just gave examples of that.
Right, and I would like to point out that there's been a tremendous, tremendous increase in environmental problems since we started fracking. And if this committee does not acknowledge that, then we can't fix it, and we can't remedy it, and we can't.
Well, you come up with some examples, and we'll look at it. Please give me some examples.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to now recognize Representative Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If I could divert for just a minute on the previous comments, and I would say that there may be some relationship between the great increase in the availability of video and such things that everyone's about the same time that fracking, of course, was becoming more popular. Members of the panel, thank you for being here today. Thank you for your service to your country. One of the bad parts about getting the last to draw is we get to beat the dead horse, so you'll forgive me for that. I'm going to try to divert with a couple other issues. Mr. Bell, I think that you and Mr. Kramer's argument aside of who is the best managed states, I think we could agree that if all states were as well managed as they are under your leadership and our governor's leadership, that we'd be talking about 50 very bright stars, and we thank you for that. And I have to say as well, I agree with your testimony that the appropriation of the royalty funds using sequestration as an excuse is frankly illegal and has to be challenged. And I also share your concern about the sage-grouse issue. It's something that we need to be continue to stay engaged in, and it could have enormous economic impacts, not just for our state, sir, but for enormous swaths of the entire West. I have to smile, as we've heard today, when you hear the administration proudly take credit for the increase in energy production, which, as we can clearly see, none of that increased production has taken place on federal lands. I think it's a little bit like the water boy claiming victory for the Super Bowl and for taking credit for that. And in this case, though, I would say the water boy was working on for the other team. I mean, this administration has been not friendly, as I think you all have demonstrated today, in helping to increase production on federal lands. I think one of the things that bothers me is this presumption as well, that this has to be a partisan issue. I don't think that it has to be. Again, there's a presumption that one party is much less interested in helping to protect our environment than another party. And so I would ask you very quickly, gentlemen, if you have seen examples of that, in your experience, have you seen examples where one party appeared to be have complete disregard for environmental laws or regulations to the detriment of people around them?
Thank you, Congressman. That may have been true at one time, but in my view, these issues of environmental damage and preservation, conservation have jumped the political track. My children, Republican, Democrat, are very concerned about the environment, and my grandchildren, and it's just becoming a concern for all of us across the spectrum. We have air quality problems. Why would we want to put our economy in a non-attainment situation? We have a bustling tourism industry. We don't want to have ecological devastation in our beautiful tourist areas, our national park areas, et cetera, et cetera. We are preserving and conserving ground and addressing these issues, hopefully with as good a stewardship as ever can be done.
And sir, I think I would agree with you. If you were not doing that, the people in your state, regardless of their party, would absolutely hold you accountable for that. Would you agree with that?
Right. Our hunters and fishermen, and et cetera, are the greatest conservationists. They want to preserve public lands because this is their playground.
Okay, thank you. And other members of the panel, I mean, have you seen a partisan divide, or do you believe that this is something that these concerns are across the spectrum?
You know, I'll go very quickly. We had two bills passed in Ohio under two different administrations. Both greatly strengthened oil and gas law in Ohio. I didn't see that it was a problem in Ohio.
Yeah, and that was a bipartisan effort.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I would add that the fracking legislation passed in Texas was passed by a majority Republican legislature to make the mandatory disclosure for industry. Industry cooperated, and the Sierra Club were on the same page in this discussion.
Okay, thank you.
I just comment that it shouldn't be partisan. I agree with you in that sense. I think for the purpose of this hearing, the primary difference is that states and federal land is that state lands often manage for a different goal.
Yeah. Well, and just in conclusion, and with my time being up, I would encourage you to not cede that ground. Again, though there are many of us who I chose to live in Utah because I love the outdoors, because I love to hike and climb and ski and do all of those things. And that, again, that's not a partisan issue. And I think we would not want to cede that ground, that because you may come from one political persuasion, that therefore you are not interested in these issues, when clearly that's not the case. And I think history demonstrates that's not the case. So thank you all again for your time.
Thank you.
And Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Representative Lummis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank our witnesses. Great panel. Lieutenant Governor Bell, several questions for you because of the tremendous similarities in the issues we have to deal with between your state of Utah and my state of Wyoming. First of all, you lost about $8.4 million due to the federal grab of your federal, your share of federal mineral royalties. Can you explain what types of things Utah would have done with that money?
It reminds me of a Cypriot haircut, Representative. That image comes to mind. It seems unfair. This is not an appropriation or a scaling back of a program. And mostly this would go to our counties, struggling rural counties. As you know, you had the biggest one of all. And $9 million is big money in rural Utah.
Are you aware that some offshore states receive full ownership of their share of royalties?
Some have speculated on the coincidence that the red states have had the haircut.
Well, I appreciate your concerns. I intend to address this issue, and I'm delighted that Mr. Stewart is also interested and concerned about this issue as well. I want to talk a little bit about the EPA's Clean Air Act guidelines and our ozone issues that we share. I know you're concerned about falling into non-attainment on ozone. We're ahead of you there. The Upper Green River Basin was declared a non-attainment zone in July of 2012. And what's tough to explain is that with emissions declining due to increased industry attention, as Wyoming Department of Environmental Quality has imposed, emissions decline. The winter of 2011 had several bad ozone days. Emissions declined some more, and 2012 was better, but not significantly different. So I think what we're finding in Wyoming is that there seems to be more to ozone in these areas than can be explained by normal urban ozone modeling. Something bizarre is going on. And we intend to reach attainment status. Is your state and mine working together to pool resources and expertise to try and understand the winter ozone issues that these basins have because they appear to be so unique?
I'm not completely aware of the cooperation, but in tandem with that, let me mention that for 3 years, because of this possibility of non-attainment, the governor organized a massive cooperative effort between the BLM, the EPA, NOAA, the Western Energy Alliance, local special service district, the University of Utah, and Utah State University to study in depth, to get the good science, not the speculation, not the politics, to get the science of this very unique, anomalous problem. We're 3 years into that. We are starting to reach some conclusions, but we need a little time to figure this thing out, because as you know, it's a very difficult problem, probably depending upon the snow cover, the amount of humidity, the amount of pollution in the air. It's just a multifaceted issue.
And isn't it true that now the nation as a whole is below Kyoto Protocol numbers for clean air, in spite of our increased use of energy?
I would take your word for that.
You can indeed, sir. Now turning to fracking, question for several of you. Does your state's fracking regulations apply to all oil and gas, regardless of who owns the mineral estate, public, private, state, federal?
In Ohio it does, yes.
And in Texas as well.
Utah?
I believe it does.
And are any of you noticing that because of that, the very same amount of oil and gas is being produced or permits to drill being issued regardless of whether it's state, federal, or private land? Or is one of them growing more than the other?
Our private production is up 100%. Our federal production is stagnant since 2008.
Ohio doesn't have a lot of federal land, but an example of a federal property would be the Wayne National Forest. Not too long ago, there was a request to lease the acreage with the intent to drill, and that was withdrawn, so it would be down.
And Commissioner Patterson?
In Texas, our federal land is not BLM. It's offshore, 9 nautical miles. And to be fair, there's not much going there, but the price of natural gas is down. Most of this is natural gas production, so I'm not sure that's a good indicator.
Thank you, gentlemen. And I'll yield back to the chair with hopes that at some point, I know you're our Energy Committee sub-chairman, as was mentioned by another member of this committee, the issue of whether our natural resources should be available for export is a subject that I would hope that we'd have an opportunity to have a hearing on sometime during the 113th Congress. I know Ranking Member Grijalva mentioned his concern about exporting, and I'd like to pursue that issue at some point, Mr. Chairman.
That's an excellent suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Representative Gohmert.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to all of our witnesses for being here. Mr. Powell, since we understand you were the Senior Policy Director for Sportsman Conservation Project Trout Unlimited, I became a huge fan of trout, both freshwater. But until I had been down and to the coast and caught speckled trout, I was not the fan that I am today, especially when those trout are mixed with butter, garlic, salt, and slivered almonds and cooked over charcoal. But anyway, I'm a huge fan now. But Mr. Patterson, you and I have known each other a long time, and like Mr. Flores, attended Texas A&M. But I can recall as a child being concerned because people were talking about drilling off our Texas coast, and I can remember so many of the adults saying, if we drill, it'll be the end of all of our Gulf fishing. It'll just devastate. And now, if you want to go fishing, my experience was they say the best fishing is around the oil rigs because they become fantastic artificial reefs for fishing. You've dealt with that issue. You're called a land commissioner, but you also deal with Texas sea issues. What's your experience?
That's accurate. The land office has many responsibilities. One of the responsibilities is we are responsible for oil spill along the Texas Gulf Coast. We have 56 FTEs. We have 5 pre-positioned locations up and down the coast from Brownsville to Beaumont. And we are the first responders to oil spills, even more so since 9/11, since the Coast Guard is more involved in security issues. What we have found is that industry and oil spill and all those things that you think of that are bad about offshore production, that is largely and dramatically a thing of the past. While we monitor all oil spills, and the number of spills has not diminished dramatically, it's in the neighborhood of maybe 500 to 800 a year, spills that used to be measured by thousands of barrels are now measured in single-digit gallons. And that is primarily because of industry self-reporting and cooperation. It is a dramatic improvement over some of the legacy issues that have been mentioned a little bit earlier today, back 50 years ago, when industry wasn't necessarily an environmental ally. Right. They are today.
Well, some are. I was shocked when we've had hearings previously about the Deepwater Horizon blowout, and I could not believe that there were about 800 egregious violations by British Petroleum, and the administration did nothing but let them keep operating out there until the horrible blowout occurred. Comparatively, I think Exxon, Shell, some of the other producers out there had 1 or 2 or none, and yet here BP had nearly 800 egregious violations. And so I hope the administration has learned their lesson. But even then, all the oil, it's amazing what nature has done with that oil like it has off the coast of California. But I wanted to address something else about the allegations about fracking. And we know I was concerned to see video, you know, somebody's lighting the gas coming out of their water, and I wanted answers. And what I have found, and I ask anybody found anything different, it has turned out in every one of those cases, it did not result from hydraulic fracking. Anybody know any different than that?
You know what, I would suggest to you that I think the source that has more credibility than YouTube is Lisa Jackson, who has stated on
well,
the
and
one
I would submit to you, I've had Secretary Salazar that I had to ask several times, are you aware of any scientific study that has ever proven that hydraulic fracking polluted groundwater? And eventually he got to the point, he agreed, no, there was no such study, but we're still looking. Well, if it happens, we want to deal with it. And so I want to mention very quickly to you, I'd filed a bill at the end of the last conference, and my friend Senator Jim Inhofe from Oklahoma filed a companion in the Senate that basically was a response to a friend, a Democratic friend, who said, we have to have federal oversight of fracking because there are some states that don't. Turns out there's a handful. The bill just says if a state has laws that and a commission or agency that oversees fracking, the federal government will not oversee in that state. Anybody have any problems with that?
No.
No.
Lieutenant Governor?
No.
Well, I would just encourage you to encourage senators and representatives in your state to get on the bill. I'm filing it again. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I'll now recognize myself for 5 minutes and then Representative Mullen. Mr. Powell, in your testimony, you attempt to justify the administration's significant delays in permitting by asserting that it is not the result of a burdensome and ponderous bureaucracy, but instead the challenge of balancing multiple use. I want to explore this notion by getting a better understanding of the lands and the process that we're talking about. First of all, when a company applies for an APD to drill on federal lands, they're normally looking for a small pad, let's say 5 acres or less, on a lease that may be many thousands of acres. Is that correct?
No, I actually don't think that's correct.
Okay, next question. I'll have to differ with you on that.
Okay.
In addition, when this is done, they're only doing so on lands that have been previously leased specifically for oil and gas activity. Isn't that correct?
Are you asking the APDs are only filed on lands they've leased? That is correct.
Okay, thank you. And prior to those lands being leased, those lands have undergone review by the agency for their suitability for leasing, and that this process will include at least an environmental assessment.
Until recently, most of the environmental reviews are very old, 10 or 15 years old. That's been one of the major issues. So yes, there's been some level of environmental review, but quite frankly, it's old, it's often inaccurate, and it's out of date.
Okay, so you're, I'll disagree that 10 years or 15 years is old, but let's go on to the next issue. Furthermore, the only lands eligible for leasing are those lands identified in a resource management plan developed by BLM. This is a 5 to 7 year process and includes a full NEPA review and is specifically designed to consider the multiple use of lands on a landscape scale, and to identify those lands which could be eligible for oil and gas activity. And isn't that correct?
Again, partially true. Certainly they are a part of either a resource management plan or a land management plan, often 10 to 15 years or even older. Many things have changed during that period of time. As those plans are being updated, we think it's appropriate to make sure we have the latest environmental and social information when those types of leasing decisions are being made.
Okay, so in essence, what you're saying is that BLM takes up to 30 times longer than a particular state to consider a drilling permit on a tiny site normally, and you're saying that they haven't got around to looking at multiple uses even though they've already done an environmental assessment and an environmental impact statement.
What I'm saying is that many of the BLM resource plans or Forest Service plans that looked at drilling are very old, antiquated, in fact, Many of those plans haven't taken into account some of the environmental issues of today, and many of those plans in the decisions that came out had very, what we would consider today, inadequate analysis performed with them.
Well, you're changing the subject because you were talking about multiple uses, and that's a different issue than whether a plan is 10 years out of date from an environmental perspective. So I'll have to disagree with your perspective on what takes them so long, what takes them up to 30 times longer. Changing the subject, Mr. Patterson, could you finish what you were alluding to earlier when you made reference to Lisa Jackson, former head of the EPA?
Well, the continued discussion about fracking, which we kind of look at, why is this occurring when we've been doing it for 50 years, as has been noted in Ohio as well, but former EPA Administrator Lisa Jackson stated, among others, I believe Carol Browner also has stated, and among others, as was noted that Secretary Salazar, that there have been no documented, verifiable, scientifically verifiable examples of groundwater contamination by fracking, and to reference YouTube as a source that's credible when compared to Lisa Jackson, who I got to know when we served on a committee, Gulf Coast Recovery Committee, and is a very credible lady, very competent lady, I think is a little bit out there. I would also point out that at least on one of these occasions, these YouTube videos, it was found out that, you know, if you take lighter fluid and you squirt it on the water, you can light it. That's what lighter fluid's about. So I would put no credence in anything I see on YouTube, and very much credence in the scientific fact and the investigations that have indicated otherwise.
Thank you very much. Now I'll recognize Representative Mullen.
Thank you, Chairman. Being the Johnny-come-lately guy to the committee, I really, all the questions that you all answered, I want to say thank you. And so I'm going to kind of take issue with this whole YouTube. I come from that industry. I come from the plumbing industry, from the pipeline industry. I own companies across the great state of Oklahoma. And, of course, we're rich in natural resources, yet I live in one of the poorest districts. And I joke every now and then, if Jed Clampton lived in our district today and he shot his black-powdered rifle and shot the ground and oil came bubbling up, he'd have to cover it up or he'd be faced with fines and probably go to jail. But the issue with the whole YouTube video, it's ironic that literally 15 years ago, this was in one of my training videos of why it was important to separate a natural gas line and a water line when you're bearing it to a house. And this video that they're showing, I don't know if this is the one that the congresswoman from New Hampshire was referencing to or not, but it showed the difference of how if a water line were to rupture at the same time the natural gas would, which this was an actual video, how the natural gas that was being serviced from the public company would enter the water line and it could go through the faucets and you could light it. And yet there has been, the broad brush has been painted by trying to put these together with fracking. There's been no such case. But as this administration does over and over again, it takes any opportunity it can to try painting whatever agenda they have in the broadest stroke to try making the coalition between the two. We live in a very rural area. We drill for our water all the time. I live on a well. The people that drill the well know they have to constantly be watching out for small pockets of natural gas because it mixes in with the oil or with the water too. And there, once again, that doesn't have anything to do with fracking. That means that God's natural resources are in the same place. You've got water and gas, they're both in the same area. What we have to do is make sure that we get the message out and that we use true facts, unlike this administration and those that oppose it that want to use theories. Theories are just absolutely a place where no common sense exists. And coming from the construction industry, I used to dread when we had Oklahoma DEQ show up on one of our job sites. Now I would probably hug them and maybe even give them a kiss on the cheek, because when you deal with the EPA, there is absolutely nothing in play that has to do with common sense. In fact, I had an EPA, as I call an agent, one time hold up his book because he asked me to do something that was non-compliable. There was no way it was possible. And he held up his book and he says, Mr. Mullen, it is not my job to tell you how to do your job. It's my job to enforce what's in this book. How you do it, I don't care. And if you can't do it, then I have the obligation to write you a fine. And he did. Still yet, what he asked me to do was non-compliable. And what we continuously find over and over and over again out of this administration, they take credit for something, that they do everything they can. If it wasn't for the great technology advancements that our private sector has created, we would see a downturn in the production, not an increase. If we could just simply bring common sense back to the state level, get the federal government out of our way, my district would turn from one of the poorest districts in the country to one of the wealthiest districts in the country. We walk on top every day of land that we own that is laced with natural resources, and yet those owners cannot afford to go through the million-dollar process it takes to get permits just to achieve the possibility of the American dream. So for those that are fighting for states' rights, I commend you. Thank you. I look forward to working with you too, because it's important to our state. Those that oppose it, I sometimes have to question, are they really putting the country first or their agenda? So thank you so much. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you all for being here. We appreciate your testimony. Representative Shea Porter.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, could I make a unanimous consent request rather than argue? Because apparently we're in a science-free zone right now. The chairman asked to be provided with examples of water contamination associated with fracking activities, and I would ask unanimous consent that a report prepared by the Democratic staff of the committee entitled Drilling Dysfunction, which includes some of the examples that the chairman requested, be included in the record.
See no objection, so ordered.
Thank you.
Once again, you're welcome. Thank you all for being here. Appreciate your testimony. And if members of the committee submit questions to you as a follow-up, we ask that you would respond to those. And if there's no other further business, then we stand adjourned.
It was a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you. Well done. Glad you were here.
There's just not enough time to go into detail.
Let's follow the science.
You know, I really think if the federal agencies would come out to Utah and Ohio and others, first we could start cooperating with each other, and then they would see that we're doing good jobs. So. Thank you, sir.